Hachette Audio presents The Holocaust, A New History, written by Laurence Rees, read by Eric Vale.
Prologue. To the Nazis, Freda Weinman's crime was simple. She was Jewish. In May 1944, at the age of 20, she was arrested in Saint-Étienne in France by collaborators belonging to the paramilitary milice. Together with her parents and her three brothers, she was taken first to the notorious holding camp at Drancy in the suburbs of Paris, and thence to Auschwitz-Birkenau in Nazi-occupied Poland. In early June 1944, the train carrying Freda, her family, and nearly 1,000 other Jews from France passed under the red brick guardhouse of Birkenau and down a railway line directly into the camp. As the doors of the freight wagon opened and they emerged into the light, Freda thought she had arrived in hell. The smell was awful. But Freda was still unaware of the true purpose of Birkenau. The place was huge and teeming with prisoners. Perhaps the new arrivals would all be put to work? As she and her family stood on the area by the side of the railway track, known as the ramp, events took an unexpected turn. Prisoners from a special unit called the Sonderkommando, dressed in pajama-like uniforms, shouted out to the new arrivals, "Give the children to the older women!" As a consequence, Freda's mother was handed a baby by a young mother in her 20s. The Jews were told to form two lines on the ramp, men in one and women in another. Bewildered by what was happening, Freda joined the line for women, together with her mother, who was still holding the baby. When her mother reached the end of the queue, an SS doctor, Freda believes it was Dr. Mengele, told her to go with the baby to the right. Freda followed her mother, but then, she recalls, "Mengele called me back and he said, 'You go to the left.' And I said, 'No, I won't. I won't be separated from my mother.' And he said in a most natural way, 'Your mother, she will be looking after the children, and you will go with the young ones, that is, the younger adults.' Freda couldn't understand why we were separated. I couldn't understand why they had to give the babies to older women. My mother was only 46 years old. I couldn't understand what was happening. It was too quick. It was all happening so fast." As Freda's mother walked away with the baby, her father and three brothers reached the end of their queue. All of them were told to stay together. But as they stood on the ramp, Freda's eldest brother, David, saw their mother moving off in another direction and thought that their youngest sibling, 13-year-old Marcel, should go with her. He reasoned that it might be easier for Marcel if his mother was able to look after him. So David told Marcel to accompany her, and Marcel, listening to the words of his elder brother, ran off to join his mother. Unwittingly, David had helped send Marcel to his death. They did not know it at the time, but they had just participated in a selection process in which SS doctors, in a matter of seconds, decided which person should be allowed to live temporarily and which person should die at once. The great majority of people on this transport were selected to be murdered immediately in the gas chambers of Birkenau, including Freda's mother, along with the baby that had been placed in her arms. The Nazis did not want children, the old, or the sick, to last more than a few hours in the camp. Freda, her father, and her three brothers had been selected to work. Though the Nazis intended all Jews to die eventually, this was at least a postponement of execution. So by sending Marcel towards their mother, David had ensured that he joined the group that had been chosen to die at once. Marcel, as a 13-year-old, was borderline for selection, and so the SS must not have cared if he went with his mother to be murdered. As Freda says, David's actions would have been the right thing to do in different circumstances, but amid the inhumanity of Auschwitz, it was the wrong decision. On the ramp, the Sonderkommando had told the young mothers to hand over their babies because the only chance they had of surviving the initial selection was to appear in front of the SS doctor without their children. Even if a mother was young and fit, the SS would rarely try and separate her from her child during the final selection process for fear of causing panic among the new arrivals. Members of the Sonderkommando had taken a look at Freda's mother as she waited by the train and decided that she was too old to survive selection. Since she was certain to die, and since the baby was also sure to perish, both had been placed together. That way, the young mother had the possibility of living for longer than this one day. How could such a situation ever come to exist on this earth? How could standards of common decency and morality have been inverted so unspeakably that the compassionate gesture of a brother directing a sibling to be with his mother helped cause his death, and the only chance a young mother had of surviving more than one day was for her baby to be taken from her and murdered? More broadly, what were the reasons the Nazis decided to exterminate an entire group of people? Why did they take millions of men, women, and children and gas them, shoot them, starve them, beat them to death, kill them by whatever means possible? What was the place of this genocide amid the catalog of other horrors that the Nazis were responsible for? For 25 years, I've thought about these questions as I wrote and produced a number of television documentary series about the Nazis and the Second World War. In the course of my work, I traveled to many different countries and met hundreds of eyewitnesses from the period, either those who suffered at the hands of the Nazis like Freda Weinmann, those who watched events as bystanders, or those who committed crimes as perpetrators. Only a fraction of the testimony gathered for my films has ever been published before. The Holocaust is the most infamous crime in the history of the world. We need to understand how this obscenity was possible. And this book, drawing not just on this fresh material, but also on recent scholarship and documents of the time, is my attempt to do just that. 1. Origins of Hate. In September 1919, Adolf Hitler wrote a letter of immense historical importance. But at the time, no one realized its significance. That's because the Adolf Hitler who composed the letter was a nobody. He was 30 years old, and yet he possessed no home, no career, no wife, no girlfriend, no intimate friend of any kind. All he had to look back on was a life filled with crushed dreams. He had wanted to become a famous artist, but had been rejected by the artistic establishment. He had longed to play a part in a German victory over the Allies during the First World War, only to witness the humiliating defeat of German forces in November 1918. He was bitter, angry, and looking for someone to blame. In this letter, dated 16 September 1919, and addressed to a fellow soldier called Adolf Jemlik, Hitler stated unequivocally who was responsible not only for his personal predicament, but for the suffering of the whole German nation. "There is living amongst us," wrote Hitler, "a non-German, foreign race, unwilling and unable to sacrifice its characteristics, and which nonetheless possesses all the political rights that we ourselves have. Everything which makes men strive for higher things, whether religion, socialism, or democracy, is for him only a means to an end, to the satisfaction of a lust for money and domination. His activities produce a radical tuberculosis among nations." The adversary Hitler had identified was the Jew. And he added that the final aim of any German government had to be the uncompromising removal of the Jews altogether. It is a remarkable document, not just because it allows us an insight into the thinking in 1919 of the man who would later instigate the Holocaust, but also because it is the first irrefutable evidence of Hitler's own anti-Semitic beliefs. In his autobiography, Mein Kampf, which he wrote 5 years later, Hitler claimed that he had hated Jews even when he was a struggling artist in Vienna in the early years of the 20th century. But some scholars have cast doubt on his simplistic version of his own past and questioned whether he really held these strong anti-Semitic views during his time in Vienna and his service as a soldier in the First World War. But that is not to say that Hitler's anti-Semitism entered into his head from nowhere in September 1919. In writing this letter, he drew on currents of anti-Semitic thought that had swirled around Germany before, during, and immediately after the First World War. So much so that not one of the ideas that he wrote about in his September 1919 letter was original. While he would later become the most...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.